thank everybody for coming tonight. We will continue our meeting. We just had an executive session for the purpose of collective bargaining. We are in the midst of negotiating our teacher contract, which happens every 3 years. And so we were discussing that in executive session. Before we get started on the official agenda tonight, Mr. Bernard has some news that I think will be exciting for the Hood community, so I want to turn it over to him.
Mr. Webster, thank you very much. At the risk of embarrassing our Hood school principal, I want to, in front of his school community, congratulate and acknowledge Mr. McKay's successful defense of his doctoral dissertation at Eastern University last week. So, well, I want to go to Mr.
It was a lot of work. I did have a lot of support from the people who worked here, and my colleagues and the school committee as well as Mr. Bernard. We'll share my acknowledgments at some point formally around that. It's just it's a thank you to all the kids for everything that they do, and a thank you to the teachers, and especially those teachers that are involved in the co-teaching model, as well as Mr. Bernard for always being supportive of the committee and kind of all the things that I do. So thank you all. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
So our first item of business, as always, is public input. Is there anybody here who is not on the agenda who wishes to be heard on any issue? Okay, thank you. Next, we have our student report, and tonight we have Bridget Drew from the class of 2020. Bridget?
Well, you heard my introduction. My name is Bridget, and I'm a sophomore. I am one of the members of the student reps to the school committee, and we present to the school committee at all of our meetings. So I'm excited to be here. Thank you very much for having me. So overall, the third quarter is kind of winding down. Seniors are getting the last of their college acceptances in, and most of those will be in by April 1st. It's been a successful academic term. Sophomores are taking the ELA MCAS tomorrow and Wednesday and Thursday, and that is the long composition and the reading and writing portions. Students have registered for their AP exams, and many students are taking practice exams, which is very helpful and offered by whichever teacher teaches the specific course. Mike Tyrell, who I'm sure a lot of you know, and Richie Colarusso will be giving an informational seminar as part of the Parent University seminar series. It will be at the Performing Arts Center, and it's on social media use in teens. And so the Parent University series, if you're not familiar with it, seeks to kind of inform parents on what their teens are doing in their general life, and maybe bridge the gap between those two groups. And the student council is offering babysitting, kind of similar to the parents' night out, so that parents can attend while their children are looked after. Student Government Day is being hosted next Friday at the State House. Caitlin Galvin and Abby Kane were selected in the beginning of the year to attend. And eighth graders have received their course selection information, and that process is kind of winding down for the current classes at the high school. This is the first year, actually, that it was done online through the PLUS portal. As a student, it was very, very helpful to not have, you know, just one sheet where you had to get all the teachers to sign. It was all done online, and just kind of improved the efficiency of that, for sure. And exciting news, Ms. Coffle is the teacher of the month. She is a geometry and algebra recalc teacher. She's wonderful, so we're very happy for that. As far as athletics go, there have been 333 students that registered for spring sports this year. Students this week will be getting their team assignments. Last week was all tryouts. Most of the practices have been inside due to the weather, but they're looking forward to those moving outside. And track and field is hosting a mattress fundraiser Saturday, March 31st at the high school. As far as other club matters, Maskers just finished their run at the MEPG State Drama Festival, where we can finish at state finals. Owen McLean and Sam Junta both won acting awards for their brilliant physical and comedic acting. We're very excited about the entire time we had together. It was a wonderful time. We thank everyone who came to our shows. Interact has been running the Pennies for Patients Drive for the entirety of March. That will be ending this Friday. And Junior Prom is April 6th at the Hillview Club. So it's been a pretty exciting few weeks. We're ready for third term to kind of wrap up and head into the last term of the year. So for my writing piece, I have an essay I wrote in my English class following The Lord of the Flies. And we were given a variety of prompts to choose from. And I chose one that either argued that humanity is naturally good or naturally bad. I believe it is naturally good, but it was easier to write an essay about the opposite. So I wrote about The Lord of the Flies and compared some of those situations in the book to the Cambodian humanitarian crisis and the ethnic cleansing of Rohingya Muslims from Myanmar. And I really enjoyed this writing piece, and you can see the number of times to that. Any questions?
Just curious, what's the little disappointment that you can't get, the students can't get outside and practice outdoor sports instead of practicing in the gym, I would assume?
Yes, I think everybody's ready to be outside, ready for some warm weather, but thankfully we have a lot of space at the high school, right. So the teams are able to use the batting cages on the upper level of the fitness center, the gym itself, the auxiliary gym, and I know the track team runs up and down the hallway. So they make use of all of this.
I just wanted to comment, if you didn't, the Maskers show was amazing. The musical was great, but this was a one-act comedy, and the kids were hysterical in the work they did. And this is the second year out of the last three that our school has made it to the state finals. So,
and that we host.
Yeah, we hosted, yes. Right? This year we hosted the semifinals round. Last year I think we hosted the preliminary round. So it's great having that facility to host major events like
it
that.
It's a lot of fun.
Any other questions,
Bridget?
Thank you,
Bridget. Thank you so much. Have a wonderful night. Thank you very much.
One other thing I wanted to say, this isn't the agenda, but I probably will talk about it later, but since we have an audience here, I'm looking forward to all of you having the opportunity to use the new restrooms at the turf field. First time, I don't know why I've never been so excited about a restroom building, but we actually can't get rid of the porta potties. If you've been to football games, it was miserable. It was right where the tickets were sold. All of that's gone. The building came on Tuesday. It's almost complete. It's a mess down there because we need to have landscaping done and paving. But I'm so happy that the community supported that because it basically completes that whole athletic complex down there where we have the softball field, the all-purpose field, the baseball field, the turf field, the track, and the team rooms, and now a public restroom and a concession stand that everybody can use and that will meet all health code regulations. So that's actually good news.
I stopped on the way here.
Okay. So next, we're going to move right into the J.P. Hood presentation. This is always the most exciting. These are the most exciting nights for the school committee. We started doing this about 10 years ago, going around in every school. And we know that it's a lot of extra work for the staff and the teachers and the students, and in some cases the parents. But it gives us a good feel as to what's going on in each school, and it also gives the school a chance to kind of show off what they want to show off. So I'll turn over to Len.
No, it was perfect. So yeah, this is a great opportunity for us to show off one of the wonderful things we do. And first, I want to start off by saying thank you for always supporting what we do here at the Hood School and always being part of our community. And we love to come out. We love to have our students here. We love our teachers being here to show off something great that we're doing. So just for tonight, we'll do a little talk about the student council and then some of the things they're doing this year. The Hood School News team has been recorded, so they'll be live here, probably. We're going to talk about two makerspace events that we have. So taking that makerspace, that hands-on learning piece that we've added, and what we've done to bring it to the next level is like a community-building activity. And then the Hood School chorus is going to sing us a song on the way out the door. So with that being said, I'd like to introduce a few things, sorry. As always, Hand in Hand Together We Can is our theme here at the Hood School. We believe that working together, teachers, families, school committee, school council, and everybody, we can accomplish a lot of goals for our kids. We've done a lot working that way, and we're very proud of it. That brings us to Saturday night's event. So Saturday night was a huge event for us. It was our annual Hood School auction, well, biannual Hood School auction, Moose Hall with Jimmy Plunkett. Very fun activity. It was engaging. We had a bunch of teachers come out. We had some amazing families, so I just want to acknowledge all their hard work. We do have a few of them here today, so if you were one of the parents involved, could you just stand up and say thank you? It's so much appreciated. There's just so many things that we want to do for our students, and that always helps us, and the funds raised go to such great things. So looking forward to talking with you and working with you to see what we do with those funds. In years past, we bought Chromebooks and we bought iPads and smartphones and all those great technology items. So we're very excited to see where that goes. So thank you.
Our pleasure.
Here's a nice picture of all the math and Woosahs, and they did a lot. And then here's some other students of the families that kind of took reign and led the event. So thank you. We also have our student council here, so welcome. And I just want to say a few thank yous before we get started. The news team, it wouldn't be possible, honestly, without Whitney Clary and Sam Anthony, who couldn't be here tonight. They spent a lot of time working with those students, and I'll let you share, and the students share what they're all about. The student council is Whitney Clary and Sadie Sherman, who could not be here tonight. And my Maker Days, I have three wonderful people always willing to help out with that event. So thank you, Audra, Whitney, and it's also Sam Anthony as well. With that being said, student council, come on up.
Hello, I'm Jackson Meister from the Hood School Student Council. I wanted to be in student council because I thought it would be really cool to do something to all my clients and to do fundraisers for them. And I found it very
interesting. Hello, I'm Nicole Holly from the Hood School Student Council. I'm so excited to have the opportunity to be on student council this year. And it's been so fun this year. And I'm so thrilled to have the opportunity to be a part of it. And I'm so privileged to have the opportunity to go to these three.
Hi, my name is Alexandra Spikis, and for me, being a student council has been an amazing experience. I am very thankful that I got the opportunity to
be here. Hi, I'm Madison Delvecchio from the student council, and I joined student council because I wanted to help out people and be a good role model by showing responsibility, respect, and behavior.
Hello, this is Francesca Cataldo from UJT, the student council. I joined student council because I want to be a great leader and help out with this.
Once again, we are Madison Delvecchio and Francesca Cataldo talking to you about the Huntsville News team.
The following video is of our fabulous news team. They are all fifth graders and they meet on Monday mornings.
Team has 8 members who write about different things like current events happening around the world and school.
The members are Alex, Macy, Teddy, Sophie, Jaden, Sophia, Matthew, and Sophia.
Know about Read Across America, the national holiday that celebrates reading, but do you know the history behind the holiday that our school celebrates every year on March 2nd? Let me tell you. One day in the May of 1997, a small reading task force at the National Education Association decided to create a holiday that celebrated reading. They wanted kids to get excited about reading. They wanted to get kids to want to read. And so, after some time, on March 2nd, 1998, the very first Read Across America was celebrated. I hope you enjoyed learning about the history of the holiday we all know as Read Across America.
Hello, this is Matthew for your Hood School News team today, and I will be reporting on what the book, If I Ran the Zoo, was all about. This book was one of Dr. Seuss's most known books. Also, did you know that it was the top seller in 2000? It was published in New York City in 1950. It was one of Dr. Seuss's classics. To end this week's story, I want to give a huge thanks to our people who read stories to our phenomenal school. Thank you to all those readers who enjoyed spending time with the JT Hood School students. And remember, have a great week at our amazing school.
Hello, this is Macy.
And Ted.
We're going to report on the project we did for school-wide Creation Station Day.
In this challenge, we need to create an animal cage to hold a bottle of magic or Play-Doh in.
The animal could be real or made up.
We could use model magic, straws, and Play-Doh glue in two pieces of cardstock.
We had a 30-minute build time, 5 minutes to plan, draw, blueprints, and you could make a Play-Doh animal to put in your cage.
Your cage must be sturdy enough to hold the animal.
You can also use straws to make your bars, and the paper could be the top.
And cut the straws for the bars. Some kids did elephants and lions.
The creation station day was so fun.
Hello, we are Sophia N.
and Sophia B.
from the Hood School News Team, and we are going to show you some of the creations from our latest Maker Day.
Here is my creation. It is a dragon cord, which is a mix of a dragon and a unicorn.
And here is my creation, City. My animal is named City because the animal is always sitting.
Here are some key other creations. A mon fox. A red robin. And a lion. Now we are going to show you a bird's eye view of everything on display in the lobby.
Maker Days, one said around Martin Luther King, and the other one was around Rio Customer every day, and she won. So I'll have Whitney Cleary come on up and just talk a little bit about the 2 days. And the interesting thing is, for me, it was a group of teachers that got together to really plan this event. And we have done so much work around the maker space and creating this environment where kids can go in and do hands-on learning, but it became questions about how to engage the community and how to engage the student population in a larger perspective and bring them all together. So the grade level switch is the huge thing for me, so I'll let you talk a little bit about that.
So basically we decided with our makerspace group that we wanted to build a community throughout the Hood School and have all of the kids work together as one and kind of feel like they were part of a family. So we had all 350 plus students separated into 17 mixed grade level classrooms, K to 5. So all of the students were given an opportunity. We had kindergartners talking with fifth graders and second and fourth graders discussing things, and they got to solve two different problems. So one of them was the Friday before Martin Luther King Day, they had to build a podium for Martin Luther King Jr. to make his speech, and they got a picture of Martin Luther King Jr. to measure up their podium, and they watched Martin's big words on the screen, and then they all got to discuss and how to make their podium. The other one was for Read Across America. We had our guest readers come in, as Matt and the news team said, to read If I Ran the Zoo, and then they all had to make the cages for the zoo animals that they created. So it was a really great experience for all grade levels to get together and talk and discuss. And a lot of the kids came away with the simplest thing of like, I made a new friend today, I met someone new today, and the kindergartner saying hi to the fifth graders in the hallway, and they're giving each other high fives, and I just thought that was a great experience to build that community.
All right, so we were hoping, since you guys have been sitting for so long, that you wouldn't mind getting up and helping us with a little activity with the fifth and the first graders. It'll only be 15 minutes. And since we figured spring is hopefully right around the corner, and a big piece to our makerspace is also getting to realize like they're engineers and that they're creating something that someday could be something even bigger. And so we try at times to get them to actually test their final products. When we did the student one, I toyed with the idea of seeing, like how sturdy the cage was and could we hold base 10 blocks on top of it and how many could you hold just to, see that durability. And then we realized we weren't necessarily sure if we could take that all on. So tonight we were hoping that you wouldn't mind working with our friends to create a boat out of one piece of aluminum foil, 5 straws, 12 inches of tape, an index card, and then we'll use the pennies for testing. So, are you okay with that?
Well, here's the problem. I don't know how to use the microwave.
Jerry and I are like the Three Stooges wiring a house and water comes out of the electrical line. So this is going to be a big problem.
Well, it might be a sinking ship for you. But you have these lovely little minds to help you
problem solve. We don't mind embarrassing ourselves.
Perfect. No one's going to be embarrassed. It's all in the fun. So we have 3 tables set up here. You can only use the materials that are inside the bag. There's also scissors in there to cut. Clearly we didn't measure the tape to 12 inches. But there's a roll of tape in there, you can use the way you would like. We typically give the kids, like what was saying, 5 weeks to kind of plan and design. I'm sure these children behind me already have their plan going of what they think to do. So there's that option to sit and discuss, and it's a great time for us to see the kids actually problem solve, because it doesn't always work out the way that they had hoped or dreamed that it was going to be. You can always go back and refine it. So do you mind if I 1, 2, 3 do? So, okay, 1, 2, 3. Here's 1, 2, 3. Oh, yeah, you need to stand. 1, 2, 3,
no,
and 1.
Is there a table?
1, 2, 3. Okay.
Your table's on your table.
Do you have any tools or anything?
Just what's in my bag. And you may not use the bag to help place it.
All right,
so
Michael, you agree with
one,
me or
is
how
about
2?
Oh,
you're 2?
Michael,
you
great.
No, I'm
not
going to get
a chance.
I think we have a chance.
All right, I'm hoping you have some ideas, right? What do you think? What do you think?
Oh, yeah.
Something like that.
kitchen.
Balance it.
come on, use them all.
Don't let him do it! I'm gonna let you hold it on.
Oh, yeah, that's solid. Oh, we got
65? Oh, no, we have like...
Oh, no! Oh, no!
Oh, no! Oh, no. That's all right.
We got 65.
55,
right? 55
times. We got a little bit more.
55.
Okay, we have
5.
How much time do we have? We still have 6 minutes. 6 minutes?
We have to ask. Oh,
ask Miss Majewski to test it.
All right. 55. Ready?
Yeah. I didn't see it.
The boat?
Not the boat. You're the
problem. You call that a boat?
Mark.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's right. You say head. All right. You guys, I let them count. You want to carefully place them in the way you want?
You got to count.
Okay. You got to count. So work together. One.
That's pretty solid. One.
I want to spread them out, right?
Trying to balance them out, right?
I would almost lose some of the points. That's okay.
That's
a little person. Was that you? How would I know that was you, Mr. Carlson?
Okay, we don't even know where my own
is. Well, you know what? We can take that one out.
Thank you.
close.
Why don't you take it back and get an actual count? Okay.
One in the air.
I can count it. Hey,
you absolutely can. That's the best part, right?
There
you go. Okay, he wants to make sure they're not.
Did you get very mad at the first time?
14. Oh, God. 15. Yeah.
Well, that's what I said to him. I said, not be the water, and the tin foil.
Oh, God, we're getting water, people.
I think you guys put on pennies after a second. It's on the video.
We did.
Guys, it's certainly competitive.
Yes.
How many?
52, 53.
Easy.
Oh, bounce it out. Yeah, what's that?
Oh, we did a fast one. How many?
60. We did 61.
They're taking on water, boys.
63. 64. Oh,
63. Oh, we tied. Good job. Oh, that can shake your hand. Good job.
Do a total count. Tegan wants a total count.
Jerry, she did it twice. Jerry, Tegan's coming for a week. So hold on. Tegan, bring it up.
So, do we have a winner?
It's high, 64. You might not want to bet.
Okay. Yes, you guys can go.
That was fun.
Thank you. Good
idea. My first
I guess we had a tie, which is always nice.
64, right?
64 total pennies?
Yep. Hey, we did it twice, 119. We didn't wait till the last minute.
We have somebody playing numbers games. I do that as well, so I can appreciate that. Again, I'm happy you got a chance to actually see that in action. One of my favorite things about that is the opportunity to watch kids take on leadership roles or take on a role working in a group. So that's definitely one of the big things for me. So let's have a round of applause for the kids and the adults. Honestly, thank you for coming out today and bringing your kids. And just we have one last little show here. We have our Hood School Chorus singing our song before everybody takes off. So again, thank you and enjoy the song.
Welcome to the Hood School Chorus. We will be performing Rhythm of the Rain for you tonight. It is a preview of our upcoming all-town chorus show, which will be performed at the Performing Arts Center at the high school on April 4th at 7 p.m. We look forward to seeing you there.
Listen to the rhythm of the rain.
Well, thank you, and thank you again to the kids. And
I just want to thank everybody. Great job on everyone. Thank you for parents for bringing your kids out. And we're going to just take a brief recess so everybody can get out of here and we can clean up and get back into our meeting. So thank you, everybody. Great job.
I was going
to put them in my pocket. Do whatever you need to. Thank you.
Okay, we'll come back into session here. That was a tremendous, every school, every town we go, we get better. Great job by the teachers setting up that hands-on exercise tonight. I really wanted to beat Jerry, but it looks like we tied, but they did it on their second vote.
We did it twice.
Yeah, exactly.
Twice. Well, you guys were playing around, we did it twice.
Right. For the record, out of deference, I let you guys win.
I figured that was the case. Okay, so next we're going to have Dr. Daniel Downs, and he's our Director of Digital Learning, and he's going to present the district technology plan. And I'm going to say I read most of it. I gleaned through, I glossed over some of it, but I read all of it. I got the substance.
That was a lottery report. I wish there were more pictures.
That was a
lottery. Lottery. Johnson.
So if you wouldn't mind, by way of introduction, Dan has done a tremendous job. One of the charges that Dr. Daly and I had for Dan when he came on board with us, was to develop the district's technology plan. Once Dan had an opportunity to get his feet wet, he became acclimated with our district, and began his work with our digital learning team, which, just as a quick aside, has done a tremendous effort from the time that we've had the model that we really feel very proud of at all five of our schools. The work that you see in this draft, Digital Learning and Technology Plan, was largely facilitated by Dan, and I'm sure he'll acknowledge the people that worked with him on its development. But I just want to thank him in front of all of you and the community for the work that he's done over a pretty significant amount of time. And I think his work to engage others in the development of the plan was very strategic because it's got kind of a broad range of folks, from students to parents to educators. And I think as you listen to Dan tonight and about how the plan has come about, he's looking for your feedback. We sent this out to the district-wide faculty today, looking for their feedback, by the way, next week to ultimately have a final plan that we can disseminate. And you'll notice it aligns with our strategic plan pretty clearly and brings it to its conclusion as a five-year plan in 2021. So with that, Dan, thank you, and I'll turn it over to you to kind of walk you through what you have done to produce this fine document.
Thank you, Superintendent. That was very kind of you. I really do appreciate on this document, on the inside cover of the work you have, you'll see a list of the principals and the library media specialists and digital learning specialists, parents and students on assisting with this plan. Great help at walking through rubrics, looking at results of our fast track surveys, which we spent a year collecting data from during the 2016 year. Most of the strategic components of this planning process that we will align in the future learning planning process. So the overall theme of this text plan is future ready, aligning with future ready schools initiative. I think you'll see in this document there are descriptions of those future ready framework, what that framework is essentially all about. Great instruction, use of space and time, robust technology infrastructure, student data and privacy, using partnerships with the community, personal and professional learning, budget resources, and collaborative leadership. The goal setting process is in the back of the plan under the area where you'll find the future ready goal assessment. That is at the back. That is the nuts and bolts of the plan. And what you'll find is as you walk through the list of initiatives in that goal, in the goal setting assessment, the future ready assessment in the back of the plan, that's where you'll find the alignment within our PS 2021 goals. So you'll see those cited specifically back there. This plan is really, as much as it is to set goals for the next 3 years, it's also about celebrating what we've accomplished, kind of moving towards the point where we set these goals that we decided to set. I look forward to implementing the first steps in setting these goals in the coming year. I think we're very strong strategically around STEAM path awareness, 21st century skills, looking closely across the curriculums, and also setting
questions or comments?
With the one-to-one initiative, I understand that you're rolling it out every seventh grade year, and eventually, by the time they're in 12th grade, it should be all there. Is the monies that we asked for through the capital improvement, is that enough to get all of them for the seventh grade?
Yes.
And in doing so, what is the life expectancy of that Chromebook as from like last year? You know, will it last them until they graduate?
Well, we're looking to get at least 4 to 5 years out of the devices. You know, and that's all projected on the life of the Chromebook. You know, as we move through, we'll have fixes, repair, fixes.
I think the good news with the Chromebook is it's really a minimal piece of technology, so there's really no onboard storage. Everything's up in the cloud, so you're kind of talking about something that, you know, maybe processor speeds are going to get faster, but where they are right now, it's not going to hurt the kids if in 3 years is the new generation of Chromebooks. I don't know.
Right. Essentially, Chromebooks have also been the same for the past 3 years till now. So a lot of the updates are through the operating system as opposed to the device itself. So if you're having
I have a couple
questions. The tech prep program as it exists now in high school, I didn't really see a lot of it referenced in here, and I don't know if you are looking to change that a bit with some of these goals.
I think the goals in here are really probably for the high school, probably will really start to be moved on probably in year two, based on the number of courses we're looking to kind of add to the curriculum. We're currently looking at updating our relationship with North Shore Community College, also updating our courses, because we're finding actually that there are a number of courses that the students could actually get tech credit for that we just haven't developed that relationship further since a couple of years ago. So I think as we add some of these newer courses, we can even look more closely at providing additional opportunities for students who are looking for more than 10 credit.
So can you talk a little bit about the personalized learning? Specifically, what that looks like besides having, you know, a one-to-one device. Like as far as curriculum goes, because I think there could be some parents out there that are a little concerned about what does that mean? What does it look like? Can you just kind of give us layman's term?
So a lot of the, you know, it's really how do we support, you know, blended with the devices instruction, you know, with teachers. So some of that could look like station rotation model where students are learning different types of components around a classroom as students rotate through the classroom. It also looks at how do we support teachers at targeting with data-assisted instruction, kind of on the teacher side. How are we working with teachers to improve the way that they develop lessons and also target learning goals for students? And also how do we best, you know, if you align it with UDL, how do we best feed the needs of all students and using technology the best way we can do that? You know, that's kind of at the core of it is we have these amazing technology tools, and we also know we want to teach all students. How can we match the technology and do that the best?
It's probably being overly optimistic to think in the next 4 or 5 years we're going to have a personal ed plan for every student, but the goal is to try to make it more personalized using the technology that we have. So that basically,
right. And technology keeps growing in leaps and bounds to assist that process of assisting students individually as well.
So it's almost like a self-learning thing. Because of the technology, students can
self-direct,
and then we can find out what abilities we have to adjust for, correct?
Right.
And so the administrators, principals, teachers say, well, these students are up here, these students need a little help on this, by basically looking at how they're self-directing in some ways, I guess.
Exactly, and it's keeping that, you know, part of the goal of this plan is keeping that conversation at this is what we're looking for, this is why we select certain tools, this is the type of instruction that we really think is important. You know, identifying the tools, matching them with, you know, the classroom environments that work best, and
just want to hit on a few things. First, you know, in the 2.5 years you've been here, getting us, you know, we're, and I know Michael was involved in this, and Patrick, and I think others, but being only one of 15 districts to get that grant for the wireless project, we might not have had that project approved if we weren't able to get such a large grant. So I want to thank you for all the work you and your colleagues put in on that. The other things are being only one of 3 districts in the Go Open project, which is excellent. You know, trying to find open source software and tools that we can use that don't cost us any money and that are going to help us in both teach and help, you know, teachers learn, basically. And then also the Maple personalized learning thing, being one of the few districts that is also a Maple district. So, you know, looking at that, it's heartening to me to see the direction that we're going in. One question I had on the, Janine mentioned the one-to-one. How's that going this year? This is the first full year with the students taking the books home. One, are they coming back in good shape every day and after vacation? And two, are we seeing differences in, I guess, how the kids are learning or the way they're learning?
Definitely. The Chromebooks have been holding up very well. The students also, the treatment of the Chromebooks has been very well. Superintendent Bernard and I, Patrick Daly and Michael actually had a conversation about that a couple of weeks ago, how impressed you were with the condition of the Chromebooks. And they actually gave us all cue back in for testing, and the students were very responsible about bringing them in, everyone was very prepared for that, and you know, that kind of seamless, you know, having the students kind of, you know, understand the responsibilities of the device has been great. In terms of the different types of tools, we've definitely seen a growth with the teachers selecting to try new tools now in their classroom, kind of working as teams of identifying new tools, upgrading lessons, meeting with them during their one-to-one meetings. We're definitely seeing a new curiosity of the teachers in terms of selecting new tools to do lessons that they may have not been able to do without the increased access to the devices. So, you know, it's really, you know, the students, you know, their lives are changing because it's, you know, they have that additional access to using the classroom, to homework at home, getting used to that process and getting prepared for school the next day with their device, and the teachers are also growing, and that they're selecting new goals for themselves and the use of technology as well.
So let me ask one follow-up on that, and then I'll turn it over to others if they have any more questions. In terms of the one-to-one, and I'm not saying there's any more money available, but if there was more money available, does it make more sense to introduce it at more grades at the same time? Or, given that we have to do more professional development, et cetera, does it make sense to do it 1 year at a time? I mean, is there any right way to implement it?
I like doing it 1 year at a time. It does help us focus on the teacher teams. Not to say that we couldn't do more than 1 year. I think, you know, it would be exciting to do more than 1 year. I think both are very possible. I think I don't think we'd be strained as a team doing more than 1 year at a time. I guess that would be the largest challenge. But I, you know, there's also that nice feature of doing 1 year at a time, the focus with the individual grade level teams and targeting that professional development and targeting those work with those students within that environment are really beneficial as well.
And I didn't finish my follow-up. Are there any grants like we got for the wireless that we could apply for to see if we could get more money to get more Chromebooks in a year?
Not through the state right now, no. But we're always looking for help and, you know, support for that.
Okay.
Well, I was hate going after you because you half the questions I write you asked right. Already.
I didn't write anything down. Yeah.
I have questions right here. Right,
my question.
The only thing I want to talk about a little bit is the budget. And I mean, I would start by just saying this is phenomenal. It's phenomenal to read this. I don't understand all of it, but it's great. I mean, since I've been coming to meetings, it just seems like we've taken huge steps in this field. And the concern I have is that we can't support it with the budget. And so I guess that's my question. And looking at this year, because I know last year to balance the budget, one of the hardest cuts at the end was some of the operating supplies and even getting, you know, being able to have licenses to use the technology. My concern is that we get these great, we get the Chromebooks, we get the school, but we don't have the resources to fully use them. So I guess my question is, how is that working this year? Because I know there were some substantial budget restrictions last year, and going forward, because it doesn't look like there's a lot of more money on the horizon, how will that impact the ability to actually implement this great plan?
So parts of this plan kind of by default do address it.
Okay.
In that, as we move forward, you know, that wireless project here at the elementary is
huge.
Is awesome. You know, that's it's just it sets the stage that if we do divide add devices in the elementaries, it mirrors the middle school, high school environment. So that's just amazing that infrastructure piece is in place. As we add devices, there's no additional cost to be able to make that those powerful use in the classroom. And that's where targeting the use of professional development resources with the teacher to keep them as cost effective as possible. And as long as, you know, right now within our environment, we don't have the huge infrastructure hurdles that come up as we add devices. So as long as we can continue to sustain our additional devices, the additional overhead is minimal as we scale devices in this year-by-year pattern.
Are we able to update materials too? Because I know last year, I think you were talking about this. Some of the materials are out of date, and the hope is with digital, some of the materials that we use, even textbooks, can be updated. Is that starting to happen too?
There's starting to be, like with the OER movement, additional resources available. So it's part of that process is identifying those resources, vetting those resources that can best assist teachers. We're still very early in the process of, you know, the digital movement, you know, digital transformation where teachers are going online for all their resources. It's heavily used, but they're not, you know, as we add devices, that's where increased access to resources for those new opportunities to look at. So we're always looking for, you know, high quality, lower cost resources to be able to implement. But the key is high quality, keeping the quality of resources the best we can as we scale devices.
I think one of the issues too on the materials is the textbook industry itself still hasn't figured out the right model from what I've seen. And initially they were pricing online materials at almost the same cost as a $300 book in college or $400 book. And people were like, what? And then they were saying, well, it's the, you know, you're paying for the rights of the authors who wrote the stuff, but it still doesn't, square.
They're trying to replace the revenue.
Right, exactly.
So they have to say, you can get it every year potentially.
Right.
Right. The only other two questions on this for me is number one, with testing. I know that the standardized testing is going to online with the new wireless. Are we at the ability that when this happens that we're going to be prepared and ready to do that? And then, yeah, sorry.
So for example, this year we just completed our infrastructure testing for the upcoming MCAS online. We were able to test everything 8th grade at the same time. The ability to do that comes from having enough devices that we already had in the middle school, and also including the 7th grade to have those devices. So we're, you know, the one-to-one initiative helps us in those areas tremendously, being able to increase the amount of student health, the infrastructure that we can test within, as more of these tests are going online, and also diagnostics for teachers to be able to improve instruction.
What about with personnel? I know we've tried to add specialists as we could, but again, I mean, I think everybody on this committee would love to put more money into some of these projects, and we just are limited in that, but how is that going with, I mean, I can't even remember, like, how many specialists are there?
So we have two K-12 specialists, we have middle high school specialists, and we have one elementary one elementary specialist in shared elementaries.
Jerry, do you have anything for
it? Yeah, just an overall general question, kind of following what Scott was saying about the budget and resources. How are we measuring up against other districts overall?
I think we're doing well. I think I think our measured approach really helps us adjust to what we need to adjust to. I think that's beneficial to be able to do it that way. You know, we didn't scale for 4 or 5 grade levels at one level and then have to make any sort of shifts. I think we're doing very well in terms of aligning ourselves with initiatives and, you know, like the Maple Initiative, the Maple's Catalyst Districts. I feel like we're at the source of, you know, we're the top knowledge around integrating technology and personalized learning and looking at a variety of resources is. And I think that's the best place to be. We need to be at the cutting edge of looking at these tools and evaluating them so that we can best implement them. So in terms of the district, you know, we're one of those top 15 districts in terms of evaluating resources to improve instruction and technology. That's how I think.
So we've come a long way with us.
Just a comment. I'm really excited about this project.
Thank you.
It's far above some of the districts that I've worked in, who are currently working, as far as support personnel, tech nutrition specialists. I think the work that our kids are doing compared to what I see is in other districts. they're enjoying it and loving it, but it's just preparing them for what they need to know in the future. On that note, I think we need to do more promotion of the fine work that we are doing with digital learning. I hear from my daughter, specifically, that she used the green screen. I hear from her teacher, you know, perhaps at open house, I see a video or something like that, but I think there's more that we can do promoting some of the cool things that our kids are doing. So I'd like to kind of offer that to you. I think that's something that, you know, whether that's done at the building level, district-wide, but I'd love for, you know, people in the town to really see some of that phenomenal work that's happening.
I just wanted to say, part of what's going to come out very soon, we're going to have this campaign called Leading the Nation, which is part of the state campaign. We're going to have it at the district level. It's going to showcase everything. Part of this, it's basically the idea behind it is, you know, we're humble, but, you know, we need to celebrate more of the great things we're doing. And so each district's going to be doing this, but we prepared sort of a website that pulls a lot of these things right to the front. Digital learning is actually the top one up on our list, and I think there's so much to showcase. And then curriculum, finance, supporting all students, all that. So I think that will be just another vehicle to showcase a little bit.
Because I think the town has made the investment, you know, especially through the capital improvement group. So I think, you know, that would you know, prove to them what we have done with.
I'll try to put the things that I share out further. You know, sometimes it's, you know, you have to share with consistency.
So jumping on Julie's idea and being one of the two old guys on the committee here. You know, they used to do things like science fairs and tech fairs. I think we still do some of them, but what about a digital learning fair? I know we don't have, I'm not asking people to do more work, and I know it's a lot of work, but some sort of, like Julie said, a district-wide event where people could come and see, you know, not necessarily, oh, look at the robot they made, but see some of the projects we're working on, see kids coding. You know, I look at Parent University coming up, and I say, maybe we could do something. So it's not this huge scale thing. You know, maybe it's a thing where we could have it in the distance learning lab and people could come through. A showcase kind of thing. And people come through, they don't sit there and listen to speeches, et cetera. We might have, you know, 50 kids in there. I don't know how many is the right answer. We've got five or six stations and they're showing, oh, every school is represented. Just something like that, which might, and I think to Julie's point, the town has invested a lot of money. It'd be a good idea to show the town what they're getting in terms of money.
And the kids love it. Look at tonight. Right. They love it.
I mean, that makerspace stuff is, you know, that's not all technology. Makerspace is just showing kids how to think, how to ask questions, how to plan, and how to get to a conclusion. And the kids at our table, we just sat there and we asked them, we said, what do you think? And they, you know, and they came up with the ideas.
I think our kids were better than
your
kids.
Really? Yeah. You're still giving it.
Well, they had the disadvantage of you.
Right. Jerry weighed down the team, unfortunately. But if we could do something like that, I'm not saying tomorrow, but I think it would be possible. And the last thing I have one last thing, and that's a philosophical thing. I've been reading a lot of articles lately about note-taking with pen and paper is more beneficial to students than taking notes on a computer. And I kind of understand that because I was a reporter for a number of years, and I have my little, you know, I was Clark Kent, but I was never Superman. I had my little notebook, and I just think the process of writing the words somehow, I don't know, makes them stick better or makes you remember them better. And I was just wondering if you, because I'm not a worry, but so we're giving the kids Chromebook in seventh grade, and you know, are the kids going to be taking notes anymore? Are they using them all the time, or how does that work?
I don't think, you know, even starting at the elementary, like on the very front cover, there's a girl, you can't tell it's a girl, on the left, she's got her iPad and she's filling out her worksheet.
Okay, yeah.
There are, you know, I know this is elementary, but there's a lot of those skills are still, you know, that. The critical thinking with the tool to assist the thinking, as opposed to replacing some of the handwriting and some of those rote skills that are really important. It's not as though those are not being done anymore. It's, you know, the kids are using those tools. As they move into middle school, you know, there is a little bit of a shift where there are students who are becoming more comfortable using Classroom. But I think you find that there are, you know, classrooms where, you know, teachers really still want kids to be the math book on the paper and do that figuring, and then enter it. And there's definitely a skill to, you know, writing and thinking and writing out the problem and then entering it into a spreadsheet or collecting data and doing multiple different processes. So, you know, I don't see that we've kind of like, there's nothing, no part of our plan has really kind of said, oh, you know, we really want everything to be digital.
So we're finding a balance, it seems like.
Yeah,
we're just
a nice balance.
Technology more.
Yeah.
Well, one question that kind of follows up on that. I didn't get to ask the fifth graders, but I assume, like the newbies group, that they write a script. So I'm sure they're writing their script, they're editing, you know, whether they're using a teleprompter or they're making, you know, handheld posters up in front for them to read from. I mean, that's my assumption, so I assume that, you know, they're doing those types of things behind the scenes as well.
I have a question, kind of two-part. It's a little bit to do with the data and the privacy, but also possibly bring in your own device. And how do you coordinate that? Are there students bringing their own device?
We enabled the students at the high school prior to being here to bring their own laptop if they wanted to the high school connect to a network through that way. There aren't students bringing their own devices specifically. Is that what you mean? There are a number of students who might be bringing their own.
I know some teachers will use phones, right? Like for
quick assessments.
Polls, assessments, Twitter. They might do products on Twitter, like the current events classes, I know.
Response type system.
Right.
And then even whether it's the smartphone or your own computer or the Chromebooks, what is the philosophy, and can you maybe explain a little bit more than the data and the privacy?
So the philosophy on the data privacy, you know, we really take a hard checking student information against, you know, companies that we're interacting with, whether they're using their app. So we've integrated several tools, one of them called Clever, to help create a barrier between our student information and the applications that we're having students and teachers use. So it's a huge component to help, you know, what they're finding is, you know, not all applications are built the same. So as applicant, you know, we're developing a process, which you see in the first year of the goals of this plan, to develop products and to be able to vet applications that students might be using in the classroom, and then be able to then have a strategic process about the application that students are using to make sure that they're compliant with what we perceive to be safe data practices.
I think one concern too is, for example, students have email addresses, but there's like, those are protected, aren't they? Or how does that work?
So that's why we use the Club.
Okay.
Is it stays behind that window. It allows them to instantly log into an application, but it's protecting their information through that portal.
But Google still has their information.
Right, you create an account.
Right.
That's the...
They own our
kids. They own everyone. They own everything.
Right.
Right. One other thing you might want to explain, I think I know how this works, but especially now that we're giving Chromebooks to students, is we basically, I don't know if we geofence, so kids can't get on Facebook and all that. How does that work?
So that's part of, you know, just our general filter that we use no matter what. It's FERPA and CIPA compliant. Our network administrator has a module which automatically goes on that layer of the network, which protects us from all those searchable terms and all that social media items. So all the students' connectivity, it's filtered, and that's required by law.
So they can't, what if a student has their own phone here, and they get onto Snapchat and Facebook?
If they have their own phone.
And they're using the data instead of being on the wireless, they can, right?
Yeah, right. They can. The agreement for the students bringing their own device, they have to use the school network.
Okay.
So they can't get on. If they did that, to circumvent it, it would be the same as them all.
Right.
The user agreement of joining our network, and that's where you get the best signal to.
Right.
So
the wireless if the data's not great, right, you're gonna get a couple
of. So you have to accept our package, and that's what the handbook says. It says that you can use this for data.
Anything else? This is a great job.
So let me just ask her if you have feedback that you would like to have the end incorporated into the plan, you can just email it to us. We will we're asking by like the end of the day on Wednesday if we look at this. The goal is to incorporate the feedback as we see fit into the document and then disseminate it widely as a final draft before the end of April. So
that's good. The only other comment I would have is in the policy subcommittee, we're going to be addressing some of the policy potentially over, you know, know, the use of, you know, handheld devices, wireless communications, things like that. So to the extent that you have any thoughts, I mean, I think you've already been talking to Mr. Bernard.
I do. We have a draft going, the one you kind of solicited, so we have that, we'll have that in the
So we're going to be addressing that next. So
my question, I was just going to ask later, but you definitely have your professional development around the proper use of social media and policies.
You'll see like those goals in the back, they really start to narrow down our scope each year, and they cover a broad range of what potential policies could look like.
So I just want to say we've come a long way in 2.5 years to having someone that's focused 100% on digital learning versus a person who split 30%, 20%, 30%, 20%, as kind of Patrick was all over the place. And I also think that you've done a good job reaching out to local industries, and I think by our participation in some of these groups, the Open Group and the Maple, et cetera, I think that helps us because those industries are there where we host an event at the Google headquarters in Boston or Cambridge. I encourage you to continue to reach out to, I know that Amazon in North Reading is very excited about working with us, and I know they'd like to do more. They've already donated a lot of computers. We might not get their brand new stuff, but 1 year old stuff at Amazon is probably like going out the door. So, I encourage you to keep reaching out and establishing relationships with local businesses, not just in North Reading, but in surrounding communities too. So,
thank you.
One more comment,
and it is a good comment. Phenomenal job. Absolutely, very comprehensive, dynamic, and I think it's taking us in the direction that we hope to go.
And forward-looking, which I think is extremely important. It would be great if we had a plan for just this year, but this looks out into the future, and it just aligns with
the remainder
about five-year plan.
So we can gear up.
Right.
Thank you.
I look forward to my invitation to the Digital Learning Fair. The Digital Learning Summit. Very good. I like that. Thank you, Dan. Okay. Next, we move to a little more sobering discussion. It's our 2019 budget. Mr. Connolly made a presentation at our last meeting of preliminary budget. The budget subcommittee has met and we discussed some areas of focus. But the one thing we really focused on that meeting was delaying our budget workshop, which was supposed to be last week. And the reason we delayed that is we're working closely with selectmen, the town administrator, town finance director, the finance committee, and hoping that we can find more sources of funding. So we, Julie and I, talking to Michael and Mike Conley and Mr. Brad, we just felt for us to have a workshop when we're still so unclear on what the final revenue numbers are going to be, or close to the final revenue numbers, it didn't make sense for us to start looking at, geez, where do we have to transfer money from here and take it from there. And so that's why our next finance planning team meeting is the 3rd of April, and then our budget workshop will be on the 4th. So we have a big challenge, and I don't know if Mike, you want to take this, but I can tell you we have our recommended budget. We right now we're $1.2 million short in terms of what the town is providing us for revenue.
The level of service.
No, that's modified level services. Yeah. Mike?
Yeah, thank you, Chairman Webster. So I think right now the recommended budget that we presented at the last meeting is really the budget we hope you will be funded and advocated for. As you alluded to earlier, there's still quite a bit of work and challenges to make that happen. Certainly. We're hopeful that there will be some updated information that you mentioned next week with the finance planning team on the meeting of April 3rd. Back together to have that budget workshop. The number will be reduced from what we were at to today. But I think there was a lot of information provided at the last meeting. I just also want to make the community aware that we'll have the opportunity that we will also be doing a budget webinar on this coming Thursday at 12 p.m. schedule an hour for a budget webinar from 12 p.m. to 1 p.m. We sent some information out to the community last week. How to register for that webinar is also on our district website, right on the budget pages. We're starting to see more folks register for that webinar on Thursday, so we hope that there's a good amount of participation in that webinar. We'll essentially try to accomplish is go through some of the information and PowerPoint slides that was presented 2 weeks ago at the preliminary presentation for those members that couldn't always attend the evening meeting. So we're trying to appeal to those folks that may be available during their lunchtime hour. It's easy to kind of just log in and even from their office or from their home and hear some of the information. There'll also be an opportunity to ask questions and so forth, either at the end of that presentation or during that presentation as well. So it will be the first time we have done that, so it will be new to us as well, but hope that it will work out. We can do some additional forums like that in the future if it works out. So that is another date to get some information, and I'll just mention that on the budget website, link that's available on the district administration website is not only the preliminary budget document is there, all of the presentations that have already taken place is there, and there are also three about 15-minute budget videos that kind of update the community along the development process, starting back to the end of January when the governor released the state budget, preliminary state aid, chapter 70 numbers, over the last several weeks have been posted. So there's a lot of information out there. We hope that we can continue to work with the finance planning team, budget subcommittee, and school committee in the coming weeks to try to get the budget that we feel is needed funded.
So before I open it to questions, just one, I did put a link up to the registration for the webinar on the Facebook page last week on the North Reading Community Connection. I'll put it up again tonight. Just our biggest challenges, as always, salaries. 83.5% of our budget is salaries. The school department has almost 400 employees. The town side probably has 100 employees. So we carry a huge, huge number of employees here. And so when you have a 2% increase in salaries, that pretty much eats up all of our budget. The other challenge is special education. We're looking at a $400,000 plus increase next year when you take into account new placements plus the reduction in state aid and circuit breaker fund. So it's about $443,000. Right, when you take those both into account.
Yeah.
So when you take those two together, it doesn't leave you much room. It doesn't leave you room for anything. We don't even have enough money to cover those two things.
I mean, that's well said. I mean, essentially, the 5.3% recommended budget, if we look at kind of new initiatives or enhancements or things that are guided by our strategic plan, out of that 5.3%, only about 0.85% is represented in the new position that we would like to fund that is guided by the NRPS 2021 document, our strategic plan. So most of that increase, as is the case in many school budgets, is guided by our salary obligations and so forth. But the special education, our district tuition members certainly major driver and factor in their FY19 budget. And many other communities in the information that I've read are also kind of faced with that similar dilemma and challenge. It's not going to be more critical, certainly. And all in the operational costs, utility, and gas, electricity, all those costs go up every year, inflation and so forth. And I think you work very, very hard to kind of keep those costs in check. Cost-saving measures, cost-avoidance measures, doing what we can. Essentially, about 4% of our is necessary increase based on things that are out of our control and it's hard for those things.
Well, our situation is further compounded than, now when Mike talked about the school department increased costs, but in addition to that, the fixed costs for the town continue to go up. And they're projecting in the last finance committee team meeting that the health insurance costs may go up as much as 7.5%, and that's optimistic. Maybe a lot more than that. In addition to that, the cost for trash removal, trash disposal is going up. The retirement costs that we have to pay are going up. So that money comes off the top, and you divide the balance between the town side and the school side, there's that much less to work with. And I'll say this, that I've been doing this for a long time, and generally this time of the year, we're optimistic that there's going to be additional revenues that will help fund the deficit in our budget. Not only do we have a deficit of over $1 million, the town has about $500,000 deficit that they're looking at right now. And I came out of that meeting the other day not a little confident, although the selectmen, the finance committee continue to work with us to try to improve our situation. But I think it's going to be a real struggle this year to try to balance it out.
Well, I'll say it every year. We are, in a lot of towns go through this. We are so fortunate to have our finance planning team, which is chairs and vice chairs of finance committee, selectmen, school committee, our business director, Mr. Bernard, town administrator, town finance director. I think that pretty much is it. And in that committee, we don't always agree. In fact, a lot of times we disagree on just about everything. But we're forced to sit down with each other at least once a month, and during budget time, twice a month, if not more. It's really helpful. We have it's a positive relationship. And without that, I think we'd be in big trouble.
And it works, because most years we go to town meeting with a balanced budget. We sit down, we work it out by the time town meeting gets it. A number of years ago, town meeting used to be the first Monday in April, and we pushed it to June because we wanted to have a better handle on the revenue picture. We still find ourselves struggling even when we get to June town meeting as to what the available revenue is.
Because a lot of times the state budget isn't settled until the end of June.
June 30th.
Because July 1st starts the new fiscal year. So, anybody else have any comments on the budget?
Only question on the document was, why is the equitable relief fund, why that have been negative?
In the last page of the handout, just talked a little bit about some of the risk, the assumption, and the liability that is kind of built into our budget development, or some of the assumptions behind our FY19 budget. And that number is a negative because we were hopeful that through the state's extraordinary relief process that we actually were, there was a possibility that we would qualify for extraordinary relief, and that essentially means that your expenses in this given year is about 25% higher than your expenses last year. This is out of the district equation. We're hopeful that we might see some additional extraordinary relief funds coming in through that process, which would be made available at the end of this fiscal year that we'll be able to use next year. So we are going to apply for extraordinary relief. We're not quite at that 25% threshold, unfortunately, so we're a little bit under that. So it's a possibility that we can see some.
And just so everybody understands how the state reimburses for special education out of district costs, North Reading is responsible for about the first 42,000 tuition.
42,000.
And then the state, anything over 42,000, the state reimburses your percentage. It's supposed to be 75.
So the program's fully funded, it would be 75%.
Right. I don't think they've ever fully funded it, correct?
They've been slightly under that for the last few years. Unfortunately, this year it's at 65%.
Beyond the 40.
So, and then the state money comes in a year later. So you're kind of working with previous year's money. Which you can balance out. And one of the things that we've done, and if we stop doing it, it would be a disaster, is at the end of each fiscal year, we prepay $100,000 to $200,000 in tuitions for the following year.
Money saved over from our
correct. Right. And if we stop doing that, we'd have a disaster.
Yeah.
So we have to, it's now built into our budget. We have to build in $100,000 or so cushion every year in our budget in order to prepay tuitions for the following year.
Right. And we've gotten into that kind of cycle. And once you're kind of in that cycle, becomes a challenge trying to break out of it. In next year's budget, as you can see on page 4, we're actually already coming up with the assumption of $150,000 in repayments. So it's even an additional risk by moving that that's there, an additional challenge trying to make that happen.
So just so everyone's clear again, we've recommended a budget of $31,198,533, correct?
Correct.
And that's 5.3% increase over last year.
Correct.
And that budget does include some new positions. It includes
badly needed new teacher at the high school. It includes the, counselor. It includes the part-time psychologist at our badge.
Psychologist is a badge, part-time reading teacher, a little, and elementary teacher, and special education.
So those five positions are essentially the difference between the modified level services budget and the recommended.
Five, six,
they're not all full-time. I think it's 3.9.
3.9 full-time. 3.9 total up to $248,000.
And you know, this is where I make my little rant every year. And maybe again, this is old guyism, but I still care a lot about foreign languages. And the foreign language program here, the teachers do a great job. The kids get a great foreign language education. We offer two languages, and we really don't start until the eighth grade. And
what do we call it?
Well, yeah, but for eighth grade. Yeah, but I'm saying the teachers do as good of a job as they can with the resources.
One year
Right. Seventh grade is kind of an experimental thing. Do I like French? Do I like Spanish? I'm going to try both a couple times a week, basically. Correct. Yeah.
But compared to other districts.
Right. And exactly. I grew up in a district that had six languages, which included Russian and Italian and German. And Latin, and French, and Spanish.
They approach it differently in the 50s, probably.
Well, that's true.
And when did you start that?
I graduated from high school.
Seventh grade.
That's when I started.
Seventh grade is when we started.
Well, you know when we started that? We started freshman year. Which is completely inaccurate. We approved a Mandarin Chinese course 7 years ago, 8 years ago. We've never funded it.
Well, was it 0.1 FTE? That's what we're looking
at. No, it was 0.4, I think, or something.
0.2.
We never funded it.
One section.
Right, one section of Mandarin Chinese. And, people think that we don't. I know a lot of people, they talk, they say, well, foreign language, that's not important. I personally believe that learning a foreign language helps you become a better learner overall because of the skills required to learn a foreign language. So that's our challenge, and hopefully our next meeting, budget workshop will be the 4th, and we've got the 9th, is that the budget hearing?
Yes.
On April 9th, we'll have a public budget hearing. We'll solicit input from the audience. We'll have the administrators in attendance to answer questions, and hopefully by then we'll have better news. I'm not thinking we're going to get the $1.2 million that we need. That would be a miracle at this point. I will say one other thing. There's been some emails going around on the, or it's actually a Twitter account of one of the Massachusetts Association of School Committee members doing a survey on how well is your district being able to keep K through 8 classes under 25. We're doing a really good job of that. I mean, our K through 8 class sizes are excellent compared to statewide. Where we suffer is the high school. We've almost made a conscious decision to keep those class sizes lower at the lower grades. And we've added some staff at the high school. We added this year. Yeah. But we've made a decision to kind of make sure we keep those.
Well, to a certain extent, the total enrollment at each of the elementary schools dictates how the class size will be to a large extent.
A lot of schools go there 27, 28, a lot of districts in there, third, fourth, fifth grades.
You're right, we've gone 318s instead of 227s.
Right.
So that's a decision.
It's a decision we can, and that's what I was getting at. We still have too many classes in the high school that are 28 and above. I think anything over 25. But if I look back 4 years ago, we don't have science labs anymore with three or four students for a lab station and equipment that doesn't work. And all of those kind of things that Mr. Ryan had to deal with for many years. So, there's been a lot of improvement, but unless the state funds education and public education at a higher level, it's going to continue to be a struggle. So April 9th will be, I invite everybody to the workshop April 4th. What time is that, John?
3:30.
3:30, it's in the superintendent's conference room.
Excuse me, 4:30.
4:30. And then April 9th, we will have the hearing at
6:30
at the district. So, anything else to budget? Okay. Next, policies.
Is there any building update for?
That is not great on SB.
No. Okay.
Policy subcommittee?
That's it.
We've finally gone through all of the MASC 99 policies. A couple were still outstanding, waiting for comments from our lawyers or other people, but we have a few for first reading here. So most of these are just, again, the MASC policies. There's also the co-op stuff we just go through. First one is on inoculation. This is something that we didn't have anywhere in our actual policies, and so we proposed adding something. It seems obvious, something that should have been there from the very beginning, and we looked and could not find anything, so we're both adding this to the section.
You want a motion?
Yeah.
Before we make a motion, I want to ask a question, because I'm getting Julie.
So is this from MASC?
Yes. Yes.
Yes.
District had no policy.
And is this, all districts are required to have these, should have these? I'm just curious as to recommend it.
I think it's best practices.
Okay.
I think the idea of the MASC policy is that a lot of school committees want guidance on what should be in there. And so we have not adopted every single one. Oftentimes, what we've done is we've put our language versus the MASC policy. Sometimes we've preferred our language, sometimes we prefer the MASC policy, but sometimes there have been new language that we don't have anywhere in the policy.
And sometimes they give us policies that don't apply to us at all, so we just don't.
So are we basically enforcing this now, but we don't have the policy in the
okay.
So Jerry, you made a motion.
Mr. Chairman, I move to approve first reading policy JGCC inoculations.
Mr. Nancy is second by Ms. Ambriano. Any further questions? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Nance.
The next one's going to be the administering of medicine to students. So you have a red line form which crosses off our current policy and replaces it with a MASC policy, which just updates the language, the main potential controversial one is the reference to Narcan, but it is being suggested by MASC, and we talked about it. We believe there should be a similar policy in there.
The only, I don't see any controversy the policy calls for the district to stock nasal naloxone or Narcan and train medical personnel and first responders may administer nasal naloxone to individuals experiencing life-threatening opioid overdose. School setting. I think it makes sense. The question is, it says the school district wishes medical personnel to train non-medical staff. That's a question that I wonder, has some thought been given to that, or is that something we need to discuss? Would just having the nurse
that's
be sufficient?
That would be correct. And also our public local public safety person, our training.
So the resource officer,
correct? Fire department personnel,
and then you're confident that that's enough people, and especially I'm just thinking of that.
I do
the size of the campus. Yeah. So it's something we could revisit if we needed to.
But yeah, I think right now with the staff that we have, certainly our public safety personnel too.
And is the nurses already trained?
No, they're not.
So once we correct this approved for second reading, next meeting, then we'll have it.
Yes, and I'm optimistic that I can continue the Narcan and the nasal naloxone through the Narcan through the state with no cost to the district.
So then I think that's my question is, we have our policy, so the school district may wish for medical personnel to be trained. Really, will this policy now give you the authority to go and
request that of our staff?
Yes.
I don't see any issue.
And when we do it, highly likely it would be at elementary school.
The things that we would do it all.
I say we still do it there. Yeah. Okay. Carry motion. No questions?
Only other clarification is that the attached regulation, I don't think there's been any changes to this. We're only talking about the actual policy right now.
Yeah, just so parents know, I mean, if you don't have a child taking medication in school, you don't need to know about this. But if you have a child and you want the nurse to administer medication, there's a whole lot of forms you have to fill out, a whole lot of things you have to read to protect both you, your child, and to protect the district.
I think that correct me if I'm wrong with the policy subcommittee, I think the thought with sharing that with you tonight was that the regulations would have been reviewed as part of the subcommittee's report.
Right.
That they were.
Could we, Mr. Buckley, read the regulations?
It had been five years.
So. I think that's a lot of regulations. We really don't.
You comfortable?
All right.
With the motion, would you move on that the regulations
would be reviewed?
Can you do that, or
do
you have to
do it?
I don't know.
Well, nothing's been changed, right?
Nothing's been changed. You can just note on there if you want that there. It says updated March 16th. So just note that.
It's a review on the regulations.
Right.
Right.
Make a motion to approve policy JGCD, first reading medications, including acceptance of, I don't know, how do you want to have
it? It's
regulations.
You change it to administering medicines to students.
Administering medicines to students. How do you want to deal with the regulations?
There's no changes.
Right. No change. Okay. All right, so we have a motion by Mr. Batsia.
Second
by Dean. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
You know, we should probably let Jerry make as many motions as we can. It's time for running out.
Julie, too. Julie, April 30th.
Time's running out as a member.
Oh, that's what I meant.
Who's gonna I thought you meant time was running out tonight. Is it midnight yet?
Who's going to read all the donations? Julie's going to. I don't like this. Okay, next policy. Scott.
Okay, so. Now we're talking about the other one, communicable diseases. This is another, I defer to you. So this is another one that we just added. I believe there's no policy again. Our medication and health services policy for lacking. So we thought we should add this one as well. Again, this is straight from MASC.
So this basically says, and I'm sure we already followed this guideline anyway, but by law, admission to school may be denied to any child diagnosed as having a disease whereby attendance could be harmful to the welfare of other students and staff. And so it's just a basic policy that lays out the guidelines for that.
It's important to have it.
Right. Should have that crosswalk. Exactly.
Now, oftentimes our handbooks have like
right.
that.
Correct.
We should have a related policy.
Yeah. Okay.
Go ahead, Jerry.
Chairman, move to approve policy JGCF, communicable diseases, first reading.
Motion, Mr. Benefizia, second by Ms. Embriano. Ready for the discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Unanimous. Before we get into this next one, I want to give credit to Julie and Scott for driving me off the time here. I said I would never vote for this policy. So.
Okay, so yeah, we spoke at the last meeting about the athletic fees and co-op, and it seemed like there was approval amongst the committee to get rid of the policy to charge for co-op teams if the fee was higher than the user fees here. And so we took the guidance of the committee, the policy subcommittee, and just the following changes, which essentially number two says regardless of the fee charged by the school hosting the cooperative team, the students shall pay that amount of the North Reading Public Schools athletic user fee.
And I think I support that, but it's something that members of the athletic subcommittee moving forward will have to keep a really close watch on.
Now, we recommend that we approve this to the athletic
yes.
subcommittee.
Yes. Yes. Mr. Brown?
I'm just going to add that the last time this was before the committee, parents of interest that we would like I said, that meeting that I would serve as a backer then let them know the disposition of the policy subcommittee was, and I did do that. I wrote to Mrs. Thibodeau and asked her if she also, I'm Mrs. Thibodeau, so I'm going to take a look at that. I told her I thought that
Chris said she could make them. She said she could make them. But I said the same thing to her.
You know, as much as I support this, the downside of this is that it could be a deterrent in the future. Trying to do other courses to be involved in some engineering costs.
But then we have to sponsor schools.
I know. While we may not give them.
But I look at it this way, Jared. And this is, you know, this is part of my conversion therapy I went through here to vote in favor of this tonight. But if we got enough girls to marry having a girls hockey team, it's going to cost us $30,000, and we're only going to be able to collect $6,000.
Right, I understand.
So if this is still going to be,
for example, if we wanted to do something like a ski team, and all of a sudden we found out that it's going to cost $3,000 for a kid to be on the ski team, we're charging $400.
We might have to cancel the program.
That's what I would say. That's the point.
Right.
The downside.
Right. But I mean, we've had issues with how much we had to pay for this, but then we looked at it and we saw that it was being spread equally among all the participants.
Yeah, we
just
that
Peabody subsidizes
more of the fee.
Right.
Way as well more. As Linfield.
And Linfield subsidizes half.
As well.
Right. So.
Okay. I'm on board.
Scott, why don't you make the motion?
Yeah.
So I move for a first reading of revised policy JHAF, titled Athletic Fees and Co-op Teams.
Second. And just make one more comment.
They're so proud of themselves.
We did have the athletic subcommittee, our last meeting did approve, recommend this, that we approve it if we move in this direction. I will say that Mr. Johnson, the athletic director, has some of the same concerns that Jerry echoed about, because we're going to have to subsidize this out of the athletic revolving account, which comes out of the students' fees. And we think we have enough money.
Yeah,
but so means
depending on the number of players.
Right. If we get 10, 12 players, then we're going to, I mean, this is something that's going to be, it's a policy, it will be a policy in 2 weeks, but we'll always have to keep a close watch on it.
Well, I would think the athletic subcommittee every year has to kind of look at the co-op participation and the cost and things, so I think, you know, that's something that we should do again.
Probably you want to have some consistency to it. And this is an interesting team because this year we had six excellent players. The team was very successful. You know, we want to maintain this, but next year maybe there's only going to be three. I don't know.
You mean the player of the year?
Player of the year, the first sophomore ever that we did.
And then, you know, and I share somewhat share Jerry's concern, but hockey has always been the most expensive sport. And it's probably always going to be the most expensive sport unless, you know, it's actually a rollerball or something like that.
Well, and I mean, just to comment on that, our thought was just making sure that we have the opportunity to participate.
Right.
There are many co-op teams. This is the only team that was more expensive than our user fee.
Right.
And we just wanted to make sure there wasn't a barrier to the young woman that wanted to participate in this program.
It was really a hockey issue, not a co-op issue.
Right, it is. It's a hockey issue. All right, so we have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Bring that all those in favor.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed. Unanimous.
And the last one, I think we're done.
This was a recommendation. Yes, we had a policy on this.
Okay. So this is just, you know, the red lines are the amendments to the change provisions of our current policy, again recommended by MASC, in particular, especially on this.
This is for non-custodial parents to access their children's records, and it lays out circumstances where non-custodial parents would not be able to access student records. And we have this policy, and we're just updating it per the guidelines or recommendations from the Mass Association of School Committees. So can I have a motion on this one, Scott?
I move the first reading of revised policy JRE entitled Non-Custodial Parents' Rights.
Second by Scott, no, any second that you whispered it to me. I'm going to give her a second. She had a frog in her that I heard it, so she gets credit.
You cleared it, and then I said second.
Motion by Scott, second by Janine. Any further discussion?
Just one comment. Sure. Do you see that FERPA is referenced in the policy as well?
Yes. That's the line. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Unanimous. Next minutes, we have the executive
session for February 26, 2018. I will take a motion to approve.
Motion to approve the executive session of February 26.
Wait a second.
Second.
Motion by Deneen, second by Scott. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Unanimous. And then we have the regular meeting of the school committee, also on February 26.
Motion to accept the regular open session of the school committee for February 26.
Second. Move a second.
Second.
Motion by Deneen, second by Jerry. Any further discussion?
Is this the one that we were talking about, the policies of the co-op at? I think this was.
Yeah, I don't think
so. No.
No.
Okay.
What's
that?
Okay. Can I cause problems for Sydney over there?
No, I just wanted to make sure that the parents were there. I think they had visitors. So.
All right.
No,
okay. Oh,
no, you're
okay.
Okay,
good.
Okay.
Scott's off his game over
tonight. Just check.
Yeah. Okay, so we have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Mr. Conley, budget update.
Yes, thank you, Chairman Webster. So in your packet this evening was the FY18 March budget report. This essentially summarizes financial activity in March. Quite honestly, not a lot of new information. Reported this month. We've talked a little bit about the same drivers, and things are certainly at play as we try to re-enter the last quarter of the fiscal year. We've talked about the out of district tuition costs, and you know, that certainly has presented a challenge this year, which, as we know, we just discussed earlier in the evening, that's certainly carrying over into fiscal year 2019. We all know the challenging weather and winter that we've had, and certainly resulted in some additional costs for snow and ice and so forth. We certainly have to manage that and address those costs in the budget at this point in the year. We typically do encumber all utility expenses, and certainly been a challenging heating season that we can try to hopefully wrap up the winter season in the next few weeks. So I'm not anticipating that we'll have any significant portion of funds available in the utility line items, but we'll continue to monitor that and move into the last quarter of the fiscal year. Certainly early on in the fiscal year, we definitely saw a lot of maintenance and needs, repair needs in several areas, mainly HVAC heating, cooling repairs, lighting, cooling repairs. We were able to manage our costs and allocate funds to. We've done a lot of budget to address these needs, but we'll continue to monitor this area as we approach the final quarter. And I think in a lot of ways, you're seeing this in the fiscal 2009 budget. So we're seeing some of these costs that are arising this year that we're dealing with reflected in that fiscal 2019 budget. Food service program, we talk about it each report at the end of each month. And I'm happy to report that the month of February, the food service program earned a small profit, a little over $1,700. At this point in the year, through the month of February, we are essentially running slightly behind. I think we're about $2,150 between where we'd like to be. That would yield a break-even program, but we still have 4 months to go. We're watching the numbers this month, and they're trending pretty well. So we're hopeful we'll be able to make that amount up and still achieve a break-even program this school year. February earning a profit, we did forecast a small loss. Usually February is a challenging month for us. Helped to make out was an amount trending about $5,000 behind last month, and down to a little about $2,150 behind the break-even program. So that being said, we're working with the food service director and Chartwells and so forth, with the staff there to be as creative as we can to help increase the revenue. We made some changes to things like the vending machine products, some small changes to try to increase some of the sales. And we also introduced a salad bar option at the high school level.
This rolled out shortly after February school vacation week, and it's been well received. It's definitely in sales coming in on a daily basis at the salad bar. So,
Did you see that there's an increase with the salad bar?
Yeah, I think we started out at about 20 meals per day, and we're seeing that kind of trend upwards. So it's definitely been some
increase. What was staff? Because I would think that would increase the staff.
That has as well.
Middle school staff are using it too.
Yeah.
I learned that today. Actually.
Yeah. So. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's
nice.
You've done a nice job.
Yeah, we can try to purchase that frequently as well. Yeah.
I could order the chicken take a French fry bar.
So how does it work? Is it, do you pay, it's still a meal, right?
It's still a meal, so it's the cost of the a la carte price meal, $3 for a student, $4 for an adult price, staff price, and you can get pretty decent portion sizes with what you're able to select, and it's good to tell you all.
It's protein available on the chicken.
Yeah, so we only get locally grown stuff, or are they?
It's only about 2 weeks.
They're using some tough quantities. Right, there's tension
given with their greenhouses. Do you hear of those things?
Greenhouses? I mean, Anna has done farm
table. Okay. Good. And as far as the vending machines, what vending machines are?
We added some vending machines a couple of years ago. They're actually, there's a staff vending machine in the staff dining area in the high school, between the high school
and
the cafeteria.
And that's through Chartwell's?
So it is through Chartwell's. Okay. So the district, Chartwell's kind of own those machines and rent those machines. So we're reaping the full revenue from that machines. And the previously, where they were sort of owned by another company, sure. And that's what the revenue and almost our small kickback or rebate. So now that we're stocking and we kind of own those machines, they're we are able to reap the full revenue.
Aren't there other ones?
There's the ones by the outcomes.
So then there's one machine that's over across from the art room, just as you come in through the gym entrance. If you turn on that first hallway to the right, there's a machine there. We've tried to publicize that machine to...
Is that just drinks?
Yeah, there's water, there's Gatorade, there's Powerade.
Kids like that. Michael and I actually went down to the gym area and pulled the kids both.
This is flavored water.
There was some guidelines to propel.
So those are ones that still the ones that there's one in each elementary school, but those are the ones that are either owned by Coca-Cola or PepsiCo product, and we get kind of a rebate, which does flow into the principal's rebate account, which helps them do some small things for the school, but they're not done through the district.
Is there any way to turn those over to Chartwell's?
Yeah, you could look at that.
Because I know, my teacher's room, for snacks and other things, so if there's any way to turn those over.
Yeah, we can certainly
take that over.
I think it's been a good decision to make that change in the school high school, because we do look at that as well. But it's between what we're trying to do with the options and even things like the vending, as well as the catering, we're still trying to push the catering program, teams to use the food service program. All of those are going to be key into getting over that hump. We're very close. We've made some great strides.
I'm going to ask about the catering. How many of that caters?
It hasn't quite taken off.
They came from Cameron University. That's largely a donation too. It hasn't.
The banquet,
they like to make their own food, and they like to have
it's kind of a culture thing. They like going to a venue, the Teresa's, the Kitties.
I was just wondering, even like some of the performances that that we use at the Performing Arts Center.
They do cater that. They do cater the competition.
Yeah, from the Massacre's competition.
Yeah.
They
do the Student Leadership Academy and annual training with the high school students. So there are a number of things they do. Those are booster events too.
Basketball boosters.
Right.
Yeah.
But the athletic season banquets just has not caught on.
Yeah, it's been a couple of
teams. Yeah.
They started doing it last year, then they kind of sort of established relationship now with the kind of repeat and use the program, but.
What is the fee for a team to rent, say, the cap or?
So that the team is no, they don't charge our own teams. They would just pay the cost, you know, if they were to use our terms program, they would.
Per person.
Yeah, there's a call, there's a mail, that is available, and how did that compare to outside vendors?
I think it's fair,
absolutely, yeah.
Outside vendors are expensive.
And we worked about a little over a year ago, revamping that menu to make it more competitive with remote, you know, more the options that would be more attractive, so.
And there are some good choices.
There's good choices, and I think the ones that we've done, we've tried to dress up the cafeteria with, you know, maybe, you know, tablecloths and so forth. But I think there's a team that just like going to those venues. It's hard to.
And not all teams do veterans.
Right now.
You know, soccer had one, basketball had not. So I mean.
Right.
Anything else, Michael?
That's it. I think on the payroll side, again, things are all within budget. As in the one changes, we're monitoring the impact of those extended leave of absences and the substitute budget, but we would remain in that. I think overall, I think we're still about a quarter left, about 3 months to go in the fiscal year. I think we're in a good position to close. You know, there'll be unforeseen things that will continue to come up, but as you know, we're hoping to do what we can to help the fiscal 2019 situation. So I think we're good standing, but it's tight at the same time as we try to meet those prepayment obligations.
To make it clear, that prepayment is already figured into the budget we're recommending.
It is, yeah.
So if we didn't have the prepayment, we're going to have to ask for another $150,000.
Yeah.
So, okay. John, no staffing changes?
There is no staffing.
Julie, would you like to do the honor one more time on the donations? I'm just trying to put it right.
Let's I'd like to make a motion that this group will vote to accept the gratitude in kind donations from the North Reading Middle School Parents Association totaling $201.74 for school activities and expenses from December to February.
Motion by Julie, second by Denise. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous.
I just make a motion that this group will vote to accept the gratitude donation of $1,000 from the Cooperative Charitable Foundation to support costs associated with the NRPS. Second.
Motion by Julie, second by Dean. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous.
I'd like to make a motion that this group will vote to accept the gratitude donation of $1,050 from the North Reading Diamond Club to support expenses associated with the Cooperative
discussion.
Just one. Just adding ages again, I'll say that.
Right.
Except before both baseball and softball.
Right. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Yes.
And that was in addition to
whatever the
last
week. Yeah.
They have some.
It was 14,007 for me.
Correct.
Yeah.
Motion
for
the school committee to accept the gratitude and donations from the North Reading High School Parents Association to support the student leadership academy and joint student program totaling $1,545 from December 2017 to February 2018.
Motion by Julie, second by Dean. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous.
Motion for the school committee to accept the gratitude and donations from
call this week, again, the generosity.
Just a comment, if I could, please. As I anticipate the donation from the Red Clover Charitable Foundation, $1,000, happy to personally the last donation that we received on that program. I just thought it was important to note that the event is being funded fully through donation. No district funds at all to run back to the person. So again, it's another example where the community steps up and the business community, industry organizations, and their individuals to support the program.
That's why I was hoping for, if we could, for everyone for this digital learning summit together.
I wouldn't be surprised
if we could get some outside donations. John, what's your final, are you at a final total for registration?
We said 74 today.
Wow.
Our goal was 50.
That's great.
So we were 74 as a today. So I sent out an email blast this morning, I think, with a reminder about signups. So, yeah, we covered you, please.
Great.
We have 12 workshops in a month, and plus the information. It's going to be a nice day.
Excellent. Correspondence?
No. There is no correspondence.
Subcommittee updates. We kind of covered policy, finance, and budget subcommittee already. So all we need is for Scott to give us an enlightening report on NORCAM.
NORCAM got pushed back till this week.
Huh?
Yeah, that huge storm coming.
Oh, that's right. That did snow it up.
The Middle Eastern.
We did cover policy, finance, planning, and budget, unless someone else, I don't think there's anything else to add on any of those. So.
I was going to ask you if you want to give up the athletic facilities.
Yeah, well, I will say again, I'm just so excited to see that building down there. We now have, that is the kind of the, it's weird to say this about a restaurant concession stand, but that's really the final piece.
Cherry
on top of the sundae, exactly, Jerry. We have if you look out from the window at the distance learning lab at the high school, it looks like a Division III college athletic facility complex. You know, down the road, somewhere along the line, when someone wealthy wants to give us $2 million to completely overhaul the baseball field and put turf in there, that would be ideal, but you know, put some lights in there. But right now, I'm pretty happy with what we have. And it's maintained beautifully. And, you know, those restaurants, everybody that's on the committee, a lot of people have been down there, looked at it. Everybody seems happy with it. The workmanship, the brick finish, fits right in with the rest of the buildings.
The interior of the concession stand is bigger than
I
thought it was going to be. Bigger than it looks, actually.
Yeah.
Front to back, it's pretty good.
And I was down there when they had the crane, and it was pretty impressive. I mean, the crane doesn't lift it too high, but it's pretty impressive to see those huge pieces just going down. And you know, you get three guys kind of shifting it around and putting it, blocking it right on the slide. So, and that should be ready to go.
It's just in time when the snow melts. We have our swimming schools out
there. Right.
I guess the time is going to be good.
Got some landscaping.
Right. Landscaping and paving.
There is, yeah. The equipment was damaged a lot of the earth.
Right.
Nothing that can't be fixed out pretty simple.
I know Parks and Rec also, Marty Tilton has an idea. He'd like to see kind of a roadway.
Yeah, you looked at that, John.
I went down. I think I just missed you. You just had Michael down. I had him down. I talked to Steve Manoa, actually, from CDI that day. I think it can work. I think it has to be a restricted access.
Right.
Either a ball alert or something.
Right.
I think it makes sense.
It would be nice
otherwise,
we're going to get
that same problem of just people we have. It's going to become a mud hole if we don't. So.
Right. But that looks great.
Michael posted a meeting today with Parks and Rec folks in Wayne about just coming to an agreement, and I know we will, but just having a discussion around the maintenance
has to be addressed
and such, so okay. That's that. It's good.
Well, maintenance and security, locking,
correct.
Unlocking.
Correct.
So one thing that's interesting, it'll have a digital lock system that can be controlled on anybody's laptop who has the the application. It's the same way that they control over at IRP. It's the same way the lights are controlled at the football field and at the tennis court. And it makes life so much easier. Same way our HVAC systems are controlled in all of our buildings, right?
And again, that complex down there, which includes the all-purpose field, the softball field, the concession stand bathrooms. A lot of people put a lot of time on that.
Five.
Five. want to give credit to my colleague, Mel Webster, who started the Athletic Facilities Committee, followed through, raised, now how much money for private donations?
$140,000.
$140,000 for private donations so that we could sod those fields, irrigate those fields, and then Mel took the initiative again to do the restrooms and the concession stands. So Mel, great job. And like I said, I mentioned Marty, I mentioned John and Michael.
A lot of people
really work hard, read them all.
It's a great committee for help. We have nothing else.
It's getting fully used.
Right. Yeah. We have nothing else to build right now, do we?
No. The town's grateful for that.
Who's in
the
hotel?
Yeah, who's in the hotel?
Great committee. Administrator report?
I have nothing to share.
Right.
Just a reminder for evaluations.
Right.
I need that, Joe.
Yeah.
And then a call for you to do.
I know.
It's on my
agenda.
I just have to put perfect scores on the whole thing.
Well, that goes without saying.
If I was valuing myself,
I don't know if it is good next year.
Well, probably.
No offense.
Okay. Let's see. The next school committee meeting is we have our budget workshop, as I said before, April 4th, 4:30 through Penn's conference room. April 9th, we have a regular meeting at 6:30 at high school, where we'll have also our public budget hearing that night. April 23rd, we may have a second budget workshop if necessary. April 30th, regular meeting at 6:30 at the Business Learning Lab at the high school, middle high school, and we will take our vote on budget. So as you can see, April 30th is not a long time to find funds for our budget, but as Mr. Venezia mentioned, Slugman and Finance Committee and Town Administrator are working hard because they have almost as big an issue as we have in terms of percentage. Anything else? Take a motion to adjourn. Motion by Julie, second by Janine. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Good night.